How is it possible in this day and age, with the knowledge we have, that there can be so much contradictory and conflicting advice available about our health and about nutrition and about medication? It seems crazy. Surely the science is what it is and facts are what they are. So I've been giving this some thought and I've come up with five factors that come into play that we need to be aware of so we can use them almost as a filter against the information that we take in, which will make it easier for us to actually come to the right conclusions. So welcome to Shape Fixer. I am Andrew, I am a nutritionist, I am trained in science, and I understand how to interpret science, and a lot of the time I like to think I can see BS when it stares me in the face. But these things are quite difficult. So here we go. Number one, and this is a difficult one because it applies to all of us, and that is cultural stubbornness. We grow up believing what we believe, and there are cultural aspects to what we eat, and we take them for granted. Bread is an absolute classic. I have a lot of my clients say to me, I've given up bread, but I really find it difficult, and I don't know what to use as a substitute. Now, that's assuming you need a substitute. You don't need a substitute. We will put anything between two slices of bread. It's a sandwich. Now you can't have a sandwich. I eat my eggs in the morning. I don't put them on toast like I used to. I don't have to put them on anything. You don't need to replace bread. You just don't need bread. Bread does not need to be a part of your life. So it's a cultural thing. We grew up with food groups and our ideas of what constitute food groups. And when we moved to Spain and our little kids went to school and they did food groups in preschool, our daughter came back and showed us that one of the main food groups was olive oil. So this is cultural, and we need to overcome those cultural preconceptions when we look at our diet and really consider what is going to be healthy and what is not. Okay, so cultural stubbornness is the first one. The second one, and this is very important, is outdated knowledge. If you're like me, I'm 60, I studied in the 80s. What I learned in the 80s about nutrition and biochemistry and how the body works is quite different from what a young medical student is learning now. And a lot of us learn what we learn, take it in, bake it in, stop thinking about it because we've got other things to think about for the rest of our lives because now we understand that thing. And that knowledge has now become belief. And when you are trying to change somebody's belief, it's very, very difficult unless they are in the process of acquiring knowledge. So then their mindset is different and they're open to learning new things, which it's very difficult to get people to learn new things about something they think they've known for a very long time. And unfortunately, this is human nature and it affects doctors as much as it does anyone else. So you will often find doctors who are practicing in all good faith their profession based on what they learned 10, 20, 30 years ago, and in a lot of cases it's inaccurate, particularly around nutrition, because historically nutrition was a very small part of a medical student syllabus. Now it's different. So I've spoken to several doctors who are sort of in their late 20s and around the age of 30, and what they understand about nutrition is very impressive. Older doctors, unless they study or keep up with the new science, will have fallen behind in the area of nutrition. What a lot of doctors do, unfortunately, because they are incredibly busy, they're under a lot of pressure, they want to study, they want to keep up, but they don't have the time, and they let the pharmaceutical companies educate them. And the pharmaceutical companies are only too happy to say, we've done some research, this is what we've found out, we've created this drug will do this, there it is. And the doctor feels like they've learned something, but they've been manipulated. So that's a very tricky one. Outdated knowledge is a big barrier to people keeping up with science. And on the subject of pharmaceutical companies, this brings me to point number three, where very often the advice you get, wherever you're getting it from, is tainted with commercial or financial interests, conflicts of interest around money. Is the person giving you the advice trying to sell you something? Big food companies manufacture a lot of processed food It's really unhealthy, but it is very easy for them to make. It lasts a long time, so their wastage is very low. It's addictive, so they like it that you buy that because it's addictive and you'll come back and get more. It's usually sweetened, it's got lots of chemicals in it, and it's very unhealthy, and they will market the food in such a way that you think it's healthy, or that you think at least there's some uncertainty and maybe it's not so bad. And they will change the names of compounds and misrepresent on the label without flat out lying, but there are ways to mislead you without actually lying, and that's for another video. So the food companies have conflicts of interest and they want you to keep eating certain things. The pharmaceutical companies have a conflict of interest because they are, well, they're not a charity, they're a company. They're a listed company with a share price, with shareholders who expect them to turn a profit. So if they can manufacture a drug that has very good results in terms of controlling symptoms of disease, but does not cure the disease, so you go on the drug for life and they can sell it to you every day for 30 years, that is a good business model. A drug that you can take for a week that will cure you and then you never need drugs again is not a good business model, and they will have no motivation to roll that drug out. So the conflicts of interest, you need to look at who's giving you advice. Are they selling you a gadget? Are they selling you a supplement? Are they selling you a medication? And understand what their motivation might be for telling you that this is healthy and this is healthy and this is not healthy and that you need that. Okay, so that is another source of conflicted interest and confusion for everybody out here. Number four is one we don't think about a lot, but it's quite obvious really if you do think about it, and that is the idea of professional credibility, or let's call it ego. If I'm a doctor, I studied in the 1980s, and I've had clients for 30 years, and I've been helping somebody manage their type 2 diabetes for the last 20 years, and giving them medication and telling them how to control their sugar levels, and I then realize that type 2 diabetes can be reversed in 3 months by changing nutrition, how do I look that person in the eye and go, you know what, I've been taking your money for 20 years and it turns out I've just been making your diabetes worse. You don't need the medication, or you will be able to go off it within the next 3 months if you change the way you eat and this is what you need to do. The humiliation, unbelievable. If there is any hope at all that I can cling to that makes me think, you know what, there is still some confusion out there, maybe, just maybe, in spite of the science, I have actually been right all along, I'm going to carry on giving that advice and prescribing that medication. Because you know what, everyone else is doing it, so it won't be my fault when it all blows up. Professional credibility, egos get in the way for a lot of people, not just doctors, dietitians, nutritionists, in the way of them keeping up, because they don't want their clients to see that they've reversed their opinions. It takes a strong kind of person to say, you know what, we were following the science has changed, guess what, this is going to be something even better. Yes, it goes against what I said before, but who knew? And then the fifth one that I see a lot of, especially here on YouTube, and hey, I've got my channel here on YouTube, is ideology. A lot of ideology, now that can be religious ideology, ethical ideology, drives the advice, because advice is often tainted by the ideas and preferences and opinions of the person who's giving the advice. That is misleading, because if you decide, for example, and I'm not picking on vegans, if you decide to be a vegan because you can't bear the thought of eating an animal, please be a vegan. But don't pretend that you made that decision because being a vegan is the healthiest option. You made that decision because you have an ethical idea around eating animals. You might believe that eating a certain way is better for the planet. You might believe that eating a certain way pleases your God. You can't then, if for example you are a non-pork eater, tell people that pork is unhealthy and that's why you don't eat it. That's not true. That is not why you're not eating it. You're not eating it for religious reasons. So a lot of channels on YouTube that push this way of eating or that way of eating are ideology driven. It's not my job as a nutritionist to choose your beliefs for you, to choose your ethics and to choose your ideology. If I feel very strongly that we shouldn't be eating animals, I cannot give you, in honesty, advice about nutrition to say that you will be healthier if you don't eat animals, just because I don't want to eat them. The science is what the science is. So my job is to look at all the science and say, this is good for you, this is not good for you, this will raise your sugars, this will help you reverse your diabetes. You then need to make your ethical decisions, and they are very important decisions on a personal level. Absolutely they are. So are mine. Your religious views, your ethical views, your ideas of what is appropriate and what is not appropriate, ideas about what crops are financial fair play, and make your decisions based on that, but at least have the science to start with. Okay, so I will give you the science, and so should your doctor, so should your dietitian, so should any of your healthcare professionals. Be honest with you about the actual science and allow you to make the ethical decisions around what you eat. So I say again, who is giving you the advice? What are they selling? And what are their beliefs? Is their advice tainted by their beliefs or by their financial interests? Have they kept up to science or are they out of date? So you, if you can, need to have a doctor who will talk to you, who will listen to you, who will debate with you. A doctor who wants to know about your sleep, your diet, your exercise, your stress. If your doctor is not discussing these things with you, then you don't have a doctor, you have a drug dealer. Good luck finding the right person. You need to not listen to one person, that's two. Don't listen to one person, don't listen to me alone. I'm just one person. I have opinions, I have views. I try to stick to the science as much as possible and reason it out and explain why I give certain advice. I will never give advice because I said so. I will explain it to you and I want you to understand the science behind what ultimately is your decision. It's not my decision. Listen to me, listen to other people too. Take it all into account and see what makes the most sense and who's backing their advice up with science. Then take your beliefs and your preferences and don't eat what makes you want to throw up. If you don't like it, find an alternative. You build your diet then around what you believe based on the advice that you're getting from people that you fundamentally can trust, because they're not trying to sell you anything. And that's why there's so much confusion and so much contradiction around what to eat and what not to eat and what's healthy and what isn't healthy. I hope that's helped a little bit. Please, if you can think of something else, add it in the comments below, because there could very well be other aspects of this that I haven't thought of. Let me know what you think. Thank you for subscribing to the channel. Thank you for sharing this video. And we will see you back here soon, I hope.